necessarily crazy about his music, were touched by Cobain's death. It was, to much of his generation, the day the music died.
I picture him in my mind, you know, pulling that shotgun to his head, and it kills me. Everything's
my fault. I think it was really stupid. I think that was like a really moronic thing to do.
I just hope that no other kids take their lives trying to be like their role model.
Kurt Cobain's band was called Nirvana, which means a place of oblivion, to care, to pain, to reality. The police who arrived at his home in Seattle were struck by the setting he chose for his suicide, a bare room, nothing there, Nirvana.
It was a totally empty room, no furniture, just Kurt's body lying on the floor. There was a shotgun lying on his chest, pointed towards his head. And behind him, about 10 feet away, there was a note into some potting soil with an ink pen was stabbed through the note to hold it down. So that was the only thing in the room.
The note only confirmed what the music world already knew. Kurt Cobain was a man as troubled as he was talented, fighting a heroin habit. And as his young fans turned the neighborhood into an instant shrine, older rock and rollers added his name to the Live Hard, Die Young list. Jimmy.
Tell me why does everything go wrong?
Janice. Come on, baby, light my fire. Jim.
The connection between Jimi Hendrix and Jim Morrison and Kurt, Janice, John Belushi, and a few other people like that is heroin.
Hank Harrison is the father of Courtney Love, Kurt Cobain's wife. He and Kurt kept in touch by computer.
I hope if anyone in the scope of my voice hears this, would be able to understand that Kurt Cobain had individual problems which are specific to him, and his suicide is not to be generalized to a whole generation.
But many of his generation were drawn to Cobain's dark and often morbid songs. Drugs and death were constant themes, and in the wake of his suicide, there were fears Kurt Cobain would take some equally anguished kids along with him. Just yesterday, a young man disturbed by Cobain's death killed himself with a shotgun outside Seattle.
Are you afraid of copycat suicides, that kids who viewed him as a hero might do the same?
I think there is a concern for that because he was such an idol and a hero in many of the young people's eyes. So actually some of the local people here and community leaders have done some actually proactive intervention, getting word out if people feel suicidal. There's numbers and hotlines to call.
Kurt's way isn't the only way. Talk it out. If you need help, call the K-Rock request lines for phone numbers that give you help.
K-Rock.
Radio stations around the country broadcast suicide prevention messages, and suicide hotlines, like this one in Seattle, logged a sharp increase in calls.
They're concerned. They're worried. They want to know, why is it that he chose to opt out and kill himself? So I think there's a natural kind of questioning about what it is, what's life mean, how do I continue going on, how do I make sense of my life?
It was a question Kurt Cobain asked over and over in his music. Starting with their first big hit, Smells Like Teen Spirit, Cobain and Nirvana spoke to a breed of teenagers and 20-somethings bummed out by the prospect of a nothing life working for nothing wages. He'd seen it firsthand back home in Seattle.
Smells Like Teen Spirit became really an anthem for this generation of all disaffiliated rock fans, a 20-something generation and teenagers. But I think that there was much more of a limit to Kurt and Nirvana's appeal when compared to such idols as Elvis Presley and John Lennon.
Seattle always had mixed feelings about grunge rock and Kurt Cobain. The music and grunge fashion gave the city a hip image, but lurking in the shadows was the heroin scene that Cobain knew so well. Last night, at clubs and rehearsal halls around Seattle, where Kurt Cobain played, his death was still topic A. Doug White is the lead singer for the band Sinister Six.
Yeah, I just picked this magazine up on the newsstand. Yeah, it's Newsweek, Suicide, it's got his picture on it. You know, why do people kill themselves? I mean, is it making too much of this, or?
No, actually, not at all. I mean, it's a shame that someone this famous has to do this before people start realizing that there's a lot of this happening in our generation, you know? It seems to me that a lot of people from my generation just don't have the coping skills to deal with life. A lot of people are, you know, they're really messed up on drugs and alcohol. You know, I don't know what it is. Maybe we can't handle not being 18 forever, where everything was cool and you didn't have to worry about having a job, you know, you didn't have to worry about anything. It's like, you know, maybe we're just all really afraid to grow up.
Has rock and roll grown up? It's been 15 years since the drug death of Sid Vicious, star of the Sex Pistols, the punk predecessors of Nirvana. Johnny Lydon was in the band and said today Kurt Cobain's death was disgusting.
I'm sick of that attitude, that rock and roll mythology stuff. And it all comes from drugs and the glorification of everything dark, grim and black. It's just so self-pitying and so self-destructive. It's not wild, it's pathetic.
But in rock and roll, as in the real world, life goes on. Kurt Cobain's 19-month-old daughter, Frances, was taken home to the house where he died yesterday. Her mother, Courtney Love, has a new album and video out today. And in record stores around the country, Nirvana albums are selling better than ever.
He's got a child, a wife. I mean, no matter what the problems were, I think it's the wrong thing to do.
He's a great musician. I respect him a lot for what he did in music and what he did for music.
His memory will live on.
In his suicide note, Kurt Cobain quoted from a Neil Young song about rock stars and death. Rock and roll is here to stay. Better to burn out than to fade away.
Next on Front Page.
He said, "It's Montana, I'm Joe Smith from the Internal Revenue Office."
Divorce and taxes.
The IRS pushed